just in here. We're talking in recreational terms to the kids.
Can Karen work for you?
Yes. We're at LSA.
So you two are Mount Diablo and you two are LSA, correct?
Okay. So now on to those topics which proved a little bit more difficult. And so what we found here were that there were significant impacts in these topical areas: cultural resources, hazards and hazardous materials, hydrology and water quality, air quality, and noise. Thus, in the case of cultural resources and hazardous materials, these are very standard findings to make. It's not at all surprising, and there are mitigation measures in there which are very standard and can take care of those things. In the case of hydrology and water quality, there are state laws which require that a project of this size, with its impervious surfaces, undertake certain subsequent follow-on mitigations. And so we've listed those. Again, all taken care of, very standardized. In terms of air quality, during the construction period, there's going to be dust from the project. It's a construction project, just like building of the rest of the school was, just like the building of your homes and roads were. And so we have a mitigation measure in there, which is the very detailed one that is required by the Bay Area Air Quality Management District that the school district will then have to enforce when they're going about construction. In the case of noise, obviously, the residence is right behind the visitor's bleachers are there. We've discussed that across page after page with the analysis. And as part of the project this time around, this is a little bit different than last time, where our mitigation measure was the sound wall. This time the sound wall is part of the project itself. And so you'll see, I would direct all of you to read that section, see how we went about doing the analysis and what the mitigation measure is. Yes, sir.
You said the district will be responsible for enforcing?
The district, as the, what in CEQA speak, is called the lead agency. They're the ones undertaking the project, and they're the ones who are doing the CEQA. You have before you. They will be responsible under that mitigation monitoring and reporting program.
Which to do what?
That's a public document, which will be published, and you can see it and hold their feet to the fire and make sure all that stuff gets taken care of. That's how it's done across the state. Same thing for cities. If a city were to build a new pool or civic center, or
this district that probably didn't meet too many of the state's requirements, but.
Okay. In this case, at least, they, if any of you are looking at it, they will have to meet all of them, because it will be very plainly laid out there. So, we, as I mentioned, we also included a chapter on alternatives, and we have three different ones. One is just do nothing alternative, don't do the project. The second one is the no sports lights alternative, so everything else stays the same but the lights. And then the third one is what we call the reduced use alternative, which would take the table in the project description, which is table 3-2, I believe. It's one you all should be familiar with if you want to understand how the site is going to be used. It basically takes that and ratchets it way down in terms of the number of events out there which would have use of lights and or PA system. It represents the next step, kind of similar to the difference between the first project that we analyzed a couple years ago and this one, which brought down the number of events. This takes it even further and eliminates some things. Yes, ma'am.
So I know that there's a lot of people here that were not here at the last meetings, and this might be their only their first exposure to this
presentation.
Yes, the project. So maybe it would be helpful, because I don't know that they've got a full understanding of what this really means in terms of the expansion of the number of nights that there's going to be games, and the expansion of the number of hours that the games are going to be held. And you know, some of those are very key to this. When you're talking about mitigating and saying a reduced
it's a fairly complex table, even for those of us who try to put it together to make sense of the use out there.
But, I understood it, so I can still get it.
Yes. Well, here's the point, though. Tonight is to be your comments in the document. It presupposes that people have looked at it.
Well,
so if folks haven't looked at the document at all,
then
that's a shortcut.
That's one of the things about the district. Sometimes they just forget to notify people.
And this is the one you took out as a long history. So what it feels like is your report is based on skewed information. I can choose my population to determine my results when I'm doing an evaluation, or I can take a general population and really get accurate results. And this feels like you have a skewed population.
That's definitely the kind of comment that I'd like to hear in about 6 more minutes. That's
okay. You again.
That's fine. We've got it. No need for that. Let's keep moving on. Let me try to address what you.
I'm sorry, who are you?
Mitchell Stark.
My name is Mitchell Stark. I'm an assistant program manager on bond programs, and I'm the project manager on this particular project. I've been working on this project for about the last year and a half, 2 years. In the previous project, one that was a mitigated negative declaration where it was just the field lighting and a PA only, there was something like 300 and some odd listed events that were going to be done with the lighting. That has been tailored down in this current version, in this EIR, in this new project, to 170 events. Note that this is not all games that where the public is on site. A lot of it has to do with the football practices so that the students can practice longer, so that they can potentially do their homework prior to coming to practice, or vice versa. That's something educational process is set up by the principal and their staff on how that is done. Okay, but I just want to make the point that a lot of these are practices. So in this table that David mentioned, table 3-2, which if you look at the graph EIR, it's on page 27, there's, and I'll just name a few. For football practices, there's 38. And this is all out of the total of 170. There's 38 events there, practice. Soccer practices, 27. Lacrosse, track, and field practice, 40. So right there, I've basically listed about 105 events that are strictly practices.
When?
In the evening,
sir. When?
They can go, and it varies in time. Okay, and that's also in the table. The football practices, 4:30 till 9 o'clock.
That's unacceptable.
Yes.
Soccer practices, 4:30 till 9 o'clock. The lacrosse track and field practice, 4:30 till 9 o'clock.
Oh, very good.
Okay, so I'm giving the flavor, like.
And are you going to use the PA system at the same time?
Actually, I think that's good information.
Let me address that real quick, okay? For the football practices, PA system, no.
Nothing.
No PA
no
system.
No portable, because we can hear the portable across the street.
Soccer practices, PA system use, no. Lacrosse track and field practices, PA system, no. So basically what it is, it's the lights. So the students can see what they're doing, and it's a safety issue for them. So to me, I've tried to give you a flavor of what this table has in it, and have shown that basically 105 events are practices.
And it's the stadium.